rumbling and thundering around and some rain here and there, and we'll just pray that the great white harvester stays away from all of our wonderful crops that we have so far this year. We need to remember Barry in prayer this morning. He's not feeling very well, and Charles, as Tuesday, he's slated to go in for his surgery, so we need to remember them as well. So it's come through COVID. I think he's survived more than anybody else I know, just about. He's been a long, hard haul the last little while. So we're just going to start by praying for them, and then we'll move into our worship service this morning. We thank you, Father, for this day that you have given us, for your goodness to us, for the many blessings that we have in our lives, how that your promise is still true, that you will never leave us nor forsake us. We thank you for the opportunity to be in your house this morning to worship you. Lord, when we look to you, we know that you will answer our prayers. You will hear our cry. So, Lord, this morning we lift up Barry to you this morning, and we pray, God, your hand would rest upon him and you would minister to him, Lord. You would bring healing to his body. Father, you would restore his strength, and that you would bring joy to his heart, Lord. We commit him into your hands because we know that you are the God who heals. We thank you, Father, for what you have done in Charles' life, Lord. You have guided him through all of these difficult circumstances. And now, Lord, he faces one more surgery again. And, Lord, we are trusting you to be there in the midst of it all. May your hand rest upon the surgeons. May you, Father, keep him strong, and may you watch over him as he goes through this surgery. We commit him into the loving hands of our Heavenly Father, for in you, Father, we have complete and utter trust. So, Lord, as we worship you this morning, help us to look to you, the author and finisher of our faith. Lord, may we worship you in spirit and in truth. In Jesus' name. Just a few announcements to remind you of this week. Wednesday, 9 o'clock, prayer here at the church. 10 o'clock, men's coffee and fellowship time here. And then Manhattan Beach is Camp 68. And coming this fall, we're going to start have an alpha. As not going to try to work it so that alpha and kids club end on the same day. Did that before, not doing that again. But we are going to start as early as we can in September for Alpha. So if you know someone who would like to come or someone that you think would come, sometimes you're going to have to come with them, okay, to help them to make that step. There's a few here that made that step to come with their friends. And so we're looking for Alpha to again this fall. And, of course, pray for Kids Club. Coming up in the fall as well, especially for the workers because they're old. And we always, you know, we've been through things that we always have to come up with something fresh. We're challenged because of the technology that kids are living in today. And so we finished on a really good note this past year, and we really want to start again on a good note as we start up our kids program this year. So just remember us in prayer, and pray for us as we are considering how to reach the next age group. We have to somehow reach them as well. And so just pray, see what God puts on your heart, what we can do, and be a blessing to them. We have our financial update from July. Started our balance with $4,146. July is our hard month because that's our tax month, you know. Well, for most of us, every month's a tax month. But so we had to pay taxes. But God, you are good. God is good. And brought in $7,758 that covered our expenses and the taxes. And we ended the month in a positive note. And I was thinking about this, how many of our small churches in our community are struggling and finding it difficult to make a go. Like our Presbyterian churches it's just hard. And so if the gospel is lost in our community, then what will our community become? And so part of it is about us being faithful in our tithes and offerings that we. And God will be faithful to you. He's never failed us. I'm not going to put the word in yet, because God never has failed us, never will fail us. He's faithful. So it's the next generations that we have to reach. They have to know that Jesus is their Lord and their Savior, not just mom and dad's. Become. And that young generation, if we reach them and we reach into their homes, we're going to see their families. You know, what's happened with my child? Why are they the way they are now before? That doesn't mean they're going to be perfect. Right? But, you know, God changes people, His Holy Spirit. So we just thank you so much for your faithful, giving. This morning is our video Sunday, and we're going to start with a little bit different. So I encourage you to just worship the Lord this morning and to turn it up. If you'd like to stand. Thank you.
blessed be your name. Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, the walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. And every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still
tithes and offerings at this time. Invite Bruce to come. Thank you. made that shot, if I'd have made this shot, if I'd have made that shot, my score would have been so much better. But you have to look back and say, but I made this shot, and I made this shot, I made this shot. If I wouldn't have made those shots, things would have been a lot different. The score could have been a lot worse. You trust in God sometimes. Well, if God would have done this, if God would have done that, if God would have done something else, how much better my life would be? Did you ever stop and say, did you know well what God saved you from? All the things that he stepped in and said, no, no, Satan, no, this is not going to happen. This is my child. Your life could have been a whole lot worse. But think about where you are now. Where you're going, and the hope you have, doesn't get much better now. Yeah. It's Communion Sunday this morning. Paul writes, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged." I invite Bruce to come. Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, when he'd given thanks, he broke the bread. Our crackers are broken to represent the broken body of our Lord Jesus Christ. Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's partake together. Lord manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. I'm reminded of the old covenant. The old covenant was with Abraham. It was a covenant that required the death of animals. Once for all. That's what it says in Hebrews. Once. So let us remember, let's partake together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your Son. He was willing to come to this earth to take on the shape of the humanity, to become human, fully human. God, fully human, that he walked among us. He knows what it means to feel hunger, to feel betrayal, to feel pain. He knows all of our temptations because he was here. But we thank you, Father, that he was more than human. He was fully God, and that in that he was able to die, to take away our sins, to give us hope, to bring us back into relationship with our Heavenly Father. Through him, we have life, life eternal, and life abundant. So God, we give you thanks for your Son. We thank Spirit, to dwell amongst us, to be our comforter, to be our teacher, to fill us with your presence every day. We give you thanks for that. We ask that you would be with us now through the rest of this service. Fill this place with your presence, Lord, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. One more song. Children's Church. I'm going to look at prayer, and I told Bruce at the beginning that the length of this sermon will be determined by you folk, because this is more of a teaching and an interactive morning this morning. Questions and answers and things that we need to just stop and think about. So before we head into that, let's just pray, okay? Father, we thank you for your goodness to us, for your many blessings, and for your word. We pray, God, that you would, by your Spirit, open our hearts to what you want to say to us. And that, Father, I ask that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart would be acceptable in thy sight. In Jesus' name, amen. So, we're going to look at a scripture verse here in Luke 11:1. It says, when he finished praying in a certain place, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, just as John also taught his disciples. Next, he said to them, when you pray, say, Our Father in heaven, may your name be kept holy, may your kingdom come, may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. And then he says, after that, he says, don't use vain repetitions, etc. We're going to look into that in a few minutes. But I want to start by saying, it's an interesting thing that the disciples wanted to learn how to pray. And then when Jesus really needed them to stand with him in prayer, they fell asleep, right? So I have some questions, and there's another set of slides there below that one. There we go. So here's some questions, and I want us to just, we're not going to rush through this morning. I want us to focus, to talk about it. What are some of the reasons we struggle with prayer? Now, I want to step back from this just a moment, okay? Give you some lead up to it. When we think about prayer, we think of difficulty, we think of struggle, we think, you know, you probably don't have this happen to you as much as I have this happen to me or to my brother-in-law Bruce, but whenever we have a family gathering, right, who do they say, okay, you know, we're going to pray for the meal, you know, who gets chosen to pray for the meal, right? Either Bruce, who's my brother-in-law and was a pastor, or me. Why? And why should we have been chosen to pray for meals? Are we any more holy than you? You know the right words. No, you praise it. Yeah, as one of my friends said, well, you're a professional prayer. And I says, what, you're amateur? Right? It isn't who prays that makes the difference. It's about the heart attitude of the person, right? And so I often look at it. How many of you, you know, have a best friend? How many of you have a best friend? Okay. How hard do you find it talking to your best friend? No, not a problem at all, right? No problem talking to your best friend, right? I need for you to stop thinking that talking to God is difficult. Because as good a friend as your best friend is, God is a better friend. You don't have to use fancy language when you're talking to God. That is what prayer is, talking to your best friend. Okay? So, what are some of the reasons we struggle with prayer? What are some of the reasons that we sometimes find it hard to pray? I'm asking a question. This isn't a rhetorical question, okay? We get distracted. What distracts us? Our thoughts?
What we have to do that day? No, that's what I get distracted with. what our thoughts, what goes through planning for the day ahead, why does it come down to the moment that we decide we're going to pray all those things in vain? That's when we finally stop to take a breath. Yeah, it could be. It's definitely one of the reasons we finally stopped moving and have, right? And remember what the scripture says, be still and know that I am God, right? But it's the be stilling part. It's coming to a standstill, not just physically, but mentally, emotionally, to engage the spirit, right? Means that everything else must stop, must come to a rest. Resting is good. Being still is good, but it's very, very difficult. It isn't just a physical action. It isn't just a physical thing to come to a place of stillness, right? When you purpose in your heart, in your mind, and your body to stop and to focus on God, you're really actively engaging in a spiritual activity. And the moment that you do that, the enemy is going to try to do as many different things as he can to distract you. The phone rings, you know? Somebody comes to the door. You start thinking about all of the things that you have to do. I could be doing this now rather than praying. I could, you know, what's going to happen down? Worries, fears, all those things begin to invade, right? Because you're not on a physical realm. You're not on a mental realm. You're engaging in a spiritual activity that can actually change people's lives. And the enemy doesn't want that to happen. He doesn't know the future. He only sees the present. He isn't God. He doesn't know what's going on, right? But there's something within us. It's that old sinful carnal nature that the minute that we decide that we're going to stop and pray, the enemy is going to take an active role against us because he doesn't want us praying. He doesn't need to be there. All that has to be there is our old physical nature, our old sinful nature taking preeminence over what is important. And we get distracted. You know, he brings all kinds of things. How many of you, when you begin to pray, you have a prayer list? How many of you have a prayer list? You know, it's okay to have people that you pray for. That's important. Because we need to lift up those who need prayer, right? But prayer is not a to-do list with God. Prayer is building a relationship with our Lord and our Savior, right? Through the Holy Spirit. He guides us. He directs us. So the minute that we begin to do that, it's going to be a struggle. How many of you have ever lifted weights in your life? Okay? How many of you found that the first time you went to lift weights, it was a challenge? It was a struggle even. No, so there's Mrs. Atlas right here. She's but, you know, when we all start, as we begin to, if you were to start lifting weights and start with the weight, you know, that someone else was beginning with, right? Say you could comfortably lift 80 pounds, okay? 70 pounds, whatever. But the person next to you is lifting 150 pounds, 200 pounds. And you try to lift their weight. How well is that going to work? You're going to hurt things. You're going to hurt your body trying to do what that other person is doing. The same thing works when we're working and when we're praying. We don't try to do and lift the spiritual weight of someone else, what someone else is doing. We don't try to be them. We need to be who we are, who God has created us to be, and to build up our prayer life, right? It just doesn't happen overnight. you know. When I'm always challenged, As a pastor, I'm always challenged by people. When we moved here, Irene, come to prayer time, and Irene was here, and she would pray, and I'm going, oh, I would love to pray like Irene. And I had to learn that God says, I don't need you to pray like Irene. I need you to pray like Evan. And I went, oh, okay. I don't have to be her. I need to be me. I need to be the person God's created me to be. And so that's sometimes the struggle I struggle with, right? So there's other, what are any other reasons why we struggle with prayer? Okay. We sometimes come and we feel like we're not worthy of God's time, right? Like, who am I? Who am I to bother God? God is Almighty God, right? You know, the psalmist says, psalmist even says, who am I, you know, that you would take time for me, right? And then God answers him, right? God answers him. You are my creation. A little higher than the angels, right? Isn't it amazing? We think angels are above us, but the reality is the angels wander around heaven at times trying to figure out why God spent his son on us. And why we have such a relationship with God. They're created beings. They're in the presence of God all the time. It says in Revelations that they fly back and forth going, holy, holy, holy is the Lord, right? And we look at them and go, oh, awesome to be an angel. Yeah, no. No, it's awesome to be a human because we get to choose God. We get to choose God. Their choice has already been made, right? So we have to, that, and can I say this? That's the old enemy sneaking up and saying, you're not worth anything. That's what you're just not worth anything. Then that's a lie, right? Because you were made, every human is made in the image of God. We're worthy because of the blood of Jesus Christ to come into his presence and to pray. Okay? And anything else? Any other reason why we struggle with prayer? We downplay what we think, right? There's that side and then the other. There's the downplay. Oh, look at everything. You know, I mean, you could take a moment, right? You could take a moment and look around the world today. We're not in Ukraine. We have houses that are actually standing. You know, we are blessed. Why do we need? Well, okay. On the other hand, right? There's the other side of that point, right? And we think that God, this is too big for God to do. Too little, too big. And Satan plays both of those on us. Well, let me ask you a question. What's too big for God to do? You believe that? Absolutely. And you should. Because we're asking the creator of heaven and earth to do something. Is there anything? And Jesus, when Jesus came, think about it. Think of all the diseases he healed, right? Leprosy, which was our cancer, right? Leprosy was a lifelong death sentence. You were going to die if you had leprosy. And yet, what did Jesus do? Healed the lepers, right? Well, blindness. That wasn't a big thing for Jesus, right? Some he spoke to, some he picked up mud. How would you like to have Jesus spit in your eye, you know? Like, you know, I always say, right in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That word God is not singular, it's plural. In the Hebrew, it's a plural word. Three people, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. So when Jesus picked up the dirt and he spit in it, and he made what? Mud. What are we made out of? Mud, right? And then he put it on that man's eyes. Jesus was doing what he did in the beginning. He created new eyeballs. Isn't that cool? You ever stop, think about that? You know? So blindness, sickness, not even death is too much for Jesus. Because he raised Lazarus. He raised a boy from the dead that had, you know? So sometimes when the enemy comes along and says, this is too big for God, just laugh. Because there's nothing too big for God, because he made everything there is. And he's in control of everything. So those are some of the struggles we have. It's not, oh Lord, it's such a small thing. No, it's not such a small thing, because it's a big thing in your life. And if it's a big thing in your life, it's a big thing to God. Right? Remember what he said? I look after the sparrows. Not a sparrow falls from the sky that I don't know about it. If he tracks the sparrows, what else did he say? He says, oh, just so you know, I know how many hairs there are on your head. That's a little thing. Big thing to God. There's nothing that's not important to him. Don't you ever let the enemy lie to you and say, no, this is too small. Yeah, we are blessed. The first thing we have to do when we recognize we're blessed is what? Be thankful, right? Have a thankful attitude. So how does the phrase, our Father in heaven, form the basis of our prayer life? He's our creator, right? Our Father who art in heaven. Our Father. Okay, so it identifies our Father, right? Apart from every other god, every other idol there is in the world, okay? But it also does something else. This is my car. This is my house. This is my Father. My God. Right? It personalizes who our Heavenly Father is. Right? He becomes, you know, read it. If you read through Scripture, it won't be very long and you'll run into Scripture where it says, you know, I'll give you an example. When Saul was brought up short by Samuel, Saul said, your God, right? Your God. That was the problem. That was the problem with Saul. Saul never identified as his God, as my God, right? And so we need to do that. So it says, what are the two ways in which someone can be a child, or what are the two ways in which someone can become part of a family? Pardon? You're born into that family, right? So the children of Israel are born into, they're born into to that special relationship, that special covenant that they have with God. They're born into it. Where's the other way? Adopted. And we are all adopted. Even the children who are called Israel need to be brought into that real family that is God, right? They need to be adopted into the family of God. They need to receive Jesus just as much as we need to receive Jesus Christ. But we are the adopted family. We are the ones that God has grafted into the tree. You know, God's tree would be His family tree would be awful barren if it wasn't for the adopted branches that get stuck on there, right? You know? A few years ago, I don't know how many years ago it is now, I got from Lori, I got this grape vine thing, right? And we put it in the ground, and I remember the first spring, I'm looking at that thing thinking, I don't know what we did, but it is one dead grapevine. Like, and it sat there, and I'm going, oh, man, whatever we did wrong. Obviously, this thing is dead. It's not going anywhere. And then that year, a little green started to happen, you know, a little green. And it started to do its thing, right? Not much, right? But it started to do its thing. Well, the next year in the spring, it looked dead again. But it came to life earlier. And that's when my daughter came out and we realized we have to make a trestle for this thing because it will take over the whole garden. If it doesn't go up, it's going to go this way, right? So we made a trestle. That year, we had a few little grapes off of it. And then the next year, it climbed up the trestle and it's got the trestle all covered and we had enough grapes on it to make some grape jelly, right? Well, this year, it's nuts. The Lord willing, we are going to have grapes coming out our ears. It has just went bananas. And I've already covered it over with the netting so that the sometimes it just takes a while for the grafted in piece to show life. But oh my goodness, when it does, what a wonderful thing. And you know, I'm not sure of all the branches that God has grafted into this tree of his. Some of us produce grapes, some of us produce apples, some of us are producing oranges, some of us are going to produce avocados, some of us, I don't know. But whatever fruit we are going to bear, it all comes because we are grafted in to that wonderful tree of life called God, called Jesus. And his life flows through us. You know, it flows out from us. And we're bearing fruit. And so adopted is wonderful, right? We have two wonderful children that couldn't be more our kids than if we'd have had them through our own flesh. But they're both adopted. I always laugh. You know, they start worrying. They see my side or they see Sharon's side and they go, oh no, what kind of kids are we going to have? Don't worry. They come from a different genetic branch. You know, they're grafted in, but they come from a different genetic branch. That we have no idea what you're going to have. Trust me. So that's a wonderful. What's the significance of being God's adopted child? You're chosen. You're chosen, right? We're protected. Yeah. What else? We're loved. Isn't that wonderful? Right? Guess what? Adopted children get the same inheritance rights as non-adopted children. Natural born children, adopted children are considered the same under the law. Isn't that amazing? You're chosen, you're loved, you're protected, you're cared for, you're provided for. Does it get any better? Does it get any better? So, I'm not sure if this question is on the next page or not, but what role does Jesus play in your adoption as God's child? What role does Jesus play in your adoption as God's child? He's our brother. he even said that, right? He is the firstborn among many children. Isn't it neat? Stop and think about this. You know, all you guys that are, you know, as we're getting older, right? You're still a child in God's sight. You're still just his child. Isn't that cool? Pardon?
Even Bruce.
Even Bruce. Yeah? We're all just children in God's sight, right? We're all his kids. Well, it's already 5 minutes after 12. Jesus cautioned his disciples about not using repetitive words. In Matthew 6, 7, and in Matthew 26, 44. Not by repeating the same words. That's what he says, right? You're not going to get God's attention by doing that, right? In what ways are we guilty of doing exactly what the verse warns us against in the Lord's Prayer? Repeating, repetitive. Do you think that by repeating the Lord's Prayer over and over and over again, you're going to get God's attention more than if you just were to say, Jesus, help me, and mean it? Does God hear our every prayer? Maybe one of the things that we struggle with is sometimes we feel that God's prayer, our prayers only go up to the ceiling and then they stop. You know that's a lie, right? You know that, remember, it's not by what we feel and it's not by what we see, but it's by faith, right? If you have enough faith to cry out to God, God hears you. Because it's not about what I see. It's not about what I feel. It's by faith. Right? We trust that what we pray, God hears. He says, I hear every prayer. In fact, in Revelation, it says that he gathers the prayers of his saints and he considers them as precious. Right? As precious. Something to be held close to his heart are the prayers of his people. So don't ever let the enemy tell you the lie that your prayer is only going up and falling back down. They're not. They're not. So what do we do? How do we, you know, when you find yourself falling into that wanting to repeat the same, maybe it's a little phrase that we use in our prayers. Well, you know, it's okay, right? Right now, interesting phenomenon is happening with my grandson, right? He, you know, he's a typical boy. I think he's Tim Taylor II, because right? But he goes, mama, 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 not dad. Mama, 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 mama. Do you think that he's always asking for mom? No. He's not. No. He's learning to do what? Talk, right? And hey, when we first have come to the Lord, we're a little bit like my grandson. It's okay. We're just learning to talk. Yep, we're just learning to talk to God. But as we grow, and don't, like, I always tell people, we rush our kids into becoming old. Let them be kids. Let them grow up at their own rate. Let them have fun. Let them be kids, right? And God's patient beyond what we can ever imagine. And so he allows us to grow in the way that we talk to him. But eventually we come to the point where we talk to him like we talk to our friends. At least that's what he desires. That we come into his presence, and it's not just our to-do list, it's not just this and this. It's, I just want to spend time. Really don't have anything to pray. I don't have a list today, Lord. I'm just coming just to be with you, you know? Yeah, it's exactly what the Lord wants to hear. It is. Yeah. He just... Yeah. Yeah. He always has a good day. It's just nice to remind him that we're thinking about him. Yeah. Yeah. And he says, yeah. Well, and we need to recognize what God is, you know, God is going to give me a good day. Regardless of all the circumstances that happen around me, do I choose to allow this to be the day that the Lord has made? And if I allow this to be the day that the Lord has made, then that's a good day for him too. Right? It's good to say, thank you for a wonderful day. I know you had a good day. I know you're going to have a good day. I just want to have a good day in the midst of your day. You know? Our communication with God has got to be two ways. You know? This is a question some of you are going to have to reach back in your memory a little ways. But how many of you have ever been out on a date with somebody that just talks about themselves? Usually the girls do that. And Sharon, that's not nice of you to say that to me. Now, the people that you want to go on a second date with are the people that ask about you. They want to know more about you. They want to get to know you, right? And if all they're talking about is them, then you know who they really love? Them, right? God wants to know you. God wants to get to know you so well that you get to know him really well too, so that you can talk back and forth. Prayer is two ways. Me talking to God and then me stopping and listening. It's not going to 99.9% of the time, there's not going to be an audible voice, but there's going to be a sense of his presence. There's going to be a sense of him being with me. There's going to be those days when I don't feel like much, but when I talk to God, I feel better. You know? And that's what it's all about. Let's close. Father, it's been really good to be in your presence today. I've just really enjoyed it. To know that you're here. To know that you care about us. Sometimes, God, in such a hurry, I just need you to help me slow down. When I stop to listen, I am just so moved by your presence. Teach me to pray. And teach me to listen. And then teach me to do what you've asked me to do. Thank you. You are an amazing friend, Jesus. We have an amazing Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that through you I can communicate. I can talk to, I can sense, and I slightly understand my Heavenly Father and my brother Jesus. Keep teaching me to the day I die. Thank you for just being who you are, God, for just being awesome. Amen. One more song this morning. Thank you.
I take him at his word and go. Christ died to save me, this I read. And in my heart I find the need of him to be my savior. That he would leave his place on high and come for sinful men to die. So once did I, before I knew my Savior. My Savior loves me, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me.
Love of God be like an ocean in your day. May the peace of God that passes all understanding overwhelm you, and may the joy of the Lord be your strength as you walk close to Jesus this week. Amen. God bless you.